judge the living and the dead. All eyes will look on your glorious face, shining like the sun. Who is like
high. author of salvation. You're the reason why we're singing for your glory. Lord, release the sound of heaven. Let it rise in every nation. We will join the anthem singing for your glory. Be lifted high, for your glory. Be lifted high. Be lifted high. Be lifted high. For your glory be lifted high. You're the everlasting Father. You're the all-consuming fire. You're the reason why we're living for your glory. We will be the generation calling down the rain of heaven. We will join the anthem singing. Be lifted high. Be lifted high. For your glory. Be lifted high. Be lifted high. Be lifted high. For your glory. glory be lifted high. Be lifted high. Be lifted high. Higher and higher, Lord. Be lifted high. Be lifted high. Higher and higher, Lord. lifted high, be lifted high. For your glory, be lifted high.
Just breathe in his presence tonight. You know, a friend of ours by the name of David Hogan, he told of a testimony where he went into a village where it was pretty much 100% chance that they would die if they went. And he has this thing that he says, you know, there's something more important than life and death, and it's the presence of Jesus. Let me tell you, his presence is reverberating in this room tonight. And his heart cry is for us to step into that, to step into the power of his presence. There's something that happens in the atmosphere when the name of Jesus is lifted up. There's something that happens in the atmosphere when the shout of the saints comes forth. With every breath, with every breath. With every breath, God, we shout for your glory, God. Come and let it fill this place tonight. Come and let it fill the city of Birmingham, God, right now. Your glory, your power, your presence, Lord Jesus, we invite you to come. We invite you to come.
Yeah.
now we're laughing about the words, the whoa, oh, oh. And just then I closed my eyes and the Holy Spirit began to speak to me about how many of our focus sometimes can be so much on the whoa, W-O-E, that we miss the whoa. Can we just take our eyes off of anything that would try to be the woe in your life? Woe is me. Woe is this calamity. Woe is this trouble. Set our eyes on Jesus and be wowed by the woe, who he is. Jesus. Father, we've just come tonight with an expectation. Lord, our heart cries this, Lord, that you would have your way, God, whatever it is that you want to do. However it looks, however it sounds, we fully surrender all that we are, all that we have, all that we want to be, God, to you. Align us, Father, with your plan in this place tonight, God. I call forth destinies of every person here. I call forth just desire for more of you. I call forth holy hunger in this place tonight, God. I call forth thirst, Lord. Thirst for more of your presence, God. Thirst for more of your Holy Spirit. Father, we're so undone. We're so undone, God, and we say we want more, Lord. The mundane is not enough. Another meeting is not enough, God. Another hour on the clock in the building is not enough, God. We want you, all that you are, all that you have, God. All of you in us, Lord Jesus. Be lifted high in this place. Come on, all over the house. Could you give him a hand tonight? Give him a shout. Come on. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, guys. How about giving our worship team a hand tonight? Wow. Wow. Shukulabasa. You know, we don't have any control over what happens all around us, but we do have control on how we respond. And I told Jason, I've shared it with a few folks. I was in a dream just a few nights ago. And Suzanne will tell you, typically I sleep so deep, I probably dream, I just don't remember. And I'm fine with that. Suzanne dreams enough for both of us. But I dreamt that we were in this, there were terrorist attacks all around us. And we were going in these places. And we were actually disarming the enemy, the plans that he had. In this dream, we were actually fighting against ISIS and radical Islam. And I remember a lot of the folks, a lot of our body was there, and we were going. And we were disarming, and we were going from house to house. And it was getting crazy, crazier and darker as we went. It was like the things they were doing was even more crazy. And as I was waking up out of this dream, I heard the Lord speak, and he had a British accent. And he said, Christians will overcome radical Islam when they become as radical for truth as they are for deception. And that is a call to us. You see, we can see all that there is to see online, and we can get afraid, and we can be afraid of calamity that could or could not come, or all of these things. But we're in a season now where more than ever, it's imperative for our eye to be fixed on truth and for us to be just enamored with truth. And so let me tell you, we get so convicted sometimes that truth and facts are one and the same, but they're not. And so no matter what you see tonight in the natural with your natural eye, don't ever take fact as truth, because truth is everything that the Word of God says. And I believe when we get radical for that, do you realize there's already people that are in the faith of Islam that nobody's going to, but Jesus Christ himself is walking into their room and introducing himself to them. And I believe that there's some church people that needs to happen for as well. For Jesus to walk in and say, hey, I'm glad you've been going every Sunday, but there's something about me I want you to know. Come on. So I just declare over our house, we're a radical body for truth and for Jesus and his presence. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, welcome to our School of the Spirit tonight. We're just so glad to see you. And for those that are watching online, we welcome you. We've got some new faces in the house, so if we could just take a minute. If you're here for the first time, why don't you lift up your hand? Got a few guests here. Come on. We've got some friends in the house tonight. I should have done a formal introduction. Anybody else here for the very first time? Jason, he'll get you real good. They're passing out visitor cards. If you will, fill it out for us. It does have some areas if you have a heart desire to do something within the church. Just check the box, turn them in, and you actually get something for that card. If you take it to the Connect Center to Amy Sky, you'll actually get a free CD download of Suzanne and I's first CD, Dawn of Zion's Glory. And so we're excited to give that to you. It's one of my favorite CDs that we've done. And the last half of it is just, I could tell you stories of how God just really came into the studio. One of the songs on there, we were actually, after it was produced, our producer was not used to manifestations of the Holy Ghost. He was actually in an encounter with God until about 1 in the morning. We were just soaking in the track to Arise, O Bride. And so it's awesome. And so if you will, fill that out. Again, we just welcome you. Do we have any kids here tonight? You got some kids? Want the kids? Come on up. Uh-oh, Sam and Ava are holding it down. Come on. First one up gets a Tootsie Roll. Uh-oh, that did it. Awesome. Anybody else? Anybody want to be a kid tonight? Why don't you stretch your hands forth to our kids? Father, we just thank you for these kids, God. We thank you for what you're doing. Lord, in our children, God, this past Sunday was off the charts, amazing. Our kids getting touched. Testimonies of kids getting healed in their bodies, Lord. So I just say, God, continue what you started. And Father, we believe that there's a revival happening right now in our children. So I just pray for wisdom, God, for the teachers, and just your power and presence to be manifested just with them tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Awesome. And Dad, love you, Dad. Richard, them legs are looking awesome tonight. I mean, if we could get a spotlight on those things, you know.
They brought their own spotlight.
No, that would be mine. Mine are like, they're like blue. Also in our bookstore, we've got two books. These are two life-changing books that we've got. One of them's Things Revealed Belong to Us. Let me tell you, it's one of those books that I could chew on over and over and over again. And we keep it in our secret place, which is the bathroom. So we read it over and over again. And so this is by one of our own. Honey Jackson actually wrote this. So powerful. If you want to change somebody's life, and just have it in a way. She just packaged it so great with personal testimonies. Anybody can read it. And let me tell you, it's just one of those awesome books. And then Free as a Lily Bird is one of our friends that wrote a book about forgiveness. And so just a few Sundays ago, I preached on offense, the three-strand cord of the enemy, unforgiveness, that the enemy was trying to do. And this book, we couldn't even orchestrated that day any better. And so there's testimonies that Amy has received from people that just with the simple children's book, as they read it to their kids, they found forgiveness for things that have been in their heart for years. And so both of these are awesome Christmas stocking stuffers, or however you want to utilize it for the Christmas season. And so without further ado, I think we're going to have Pastor Hooper come and do our offering tonight. Pastor Hooper. Pastor. Did I miss anything?
Also, just real quickly as well, this coming Friday, we have our last Friday Night Fire. And for those of you who have not been a part of our Friday Night Fire, it's just kind of like a, hey, let's see what God wants to do meeting. And Holy Spirit, come, and we're going to follow your lead. And, of course, it's our Friday Night Fire. We'll also, of course, have a movie. We'll turn the Fellowship Hall into a movie theater for the kids. And also, for those of you who don't know, in January, we're going to move to a 9 and 11 o'clock expression. I hate to call them services because that kind of, like, encapsulates them almost in a wrong way. But 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock expressions of what we feel like God has given us to really to carry and to steward in this city. And so if you've not yet told some of your friends and your family about that, we know there's a bunch of folks who have come through, and having an option like that, even a shorter, like a 9 to 10:30 opportunity for people to come in, to be able to be a part of worship, to get the word, to receive ministry, and really to experience what God is doing in this place, and then to get on with their day. You know, I know some people, Sunday's the only day that they really have as a family day. And so we wanted to be able to have a way to where we could continue to pursue more of God while also making it available to more people. Amen? And so speaking of people, I know it's a Christmas holiday, and it seems like, you know, folks are a little sparse tonight, you know, taking care of Christmas festivities and this and that. But I do want to welcome, I know we have a lot of our folks who are watching by way of the web, especially want to give a shout out to Kimberly Horn and the Horn Boys. Come on, I know you guys are at home watching, and as are just a whole lot of our Kingsway family tonight. And I'm going to receive the offering, and how many of you excited to give tonight? Oh, come on now. How many of you excited? God loves a cheerful giver. Come on now. And so I'm going to be receiving the offering tonight, and then we've got some special treats. We've got some special guests. James Rodgers is going to be sharing tonight. Where's James at? Oh, there he is. And James is going to be sharing, and then also Paige, Honey Jackson, is going to be sharing as well, Faith to Move Mountains, and we're going to be looking at binding and loosening tonight, and just have an awesome time in God, amen? But you know what, as I was praying about, Lord, how would you have us to receive the offering tonight, I just began to reflect on so much of what I'm seeing God do in and through the family of Kingsway Church. And yesterday was our food distribution, and through your generosity, we were able to feed 148 families. I think the count was like 441 individuals. Is that right, Eva? She says it sounds right. And not only that, but also we had 8 people give their life to Jesus for the very first time. Can we thank the Lord for that? Come on now. Just all kinds of folks healed and touched and filled with the Holy Spirit. And, you know, and honestly, we couldn't do any of that if it wasn't for you. And I was talking to somebody this morning, and I said, you know what? I said, really? I said, you know, whether it's our food distribution or the clothing ministry of Kingsway, all of that is worship. Jesus said it like this in Matthew 25. He talked about, you know, that whatever we do to the least of these, we've done unto him. And he said, when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was in prison, you came and you saw me. And they said, Lord, when were you hungry? When were you thirsty and we gave you a drink? When were you naked and we clothed you? When were you in prison and we came to you? And he said, whatever you've done to the least of these, you've done to me. And so the beauty is whenever we manifest the kingdom and we release the generosity of a God so loved that he gave, that's actually worship. Not only are we helping to meet natural needs in the lives of those around us, but that is an unto the Lord portion. Amen? And so as I was praying this morning, the Lord put a scripture that's on my heart that is familiar to all of us, and it's the story about the widow with two mites. How many of you are familiar with this? And one of the things the Lord started speaking to my heart is that God measures our contribution in the context of our capacity. God measures our contribution in the context of our capacity. In other words, we see here in this story that there were folks who were very affluent, and they could give a lot and it not really cost them anything. And then there's this one woman, this one widow, who what she gave looked small in the eyes of others, but it was big in her heart. Amen? And so let's pick up Mark chapter 12, verse 41. I believe Laura's going to put it on the screen for us. Mark 12, 41. If you have your Bible, go ahead and open up. If you have your Bible app, go ahead and scroll to it. You know, there's something about hearing the word and seeing the word that just helps us really lay hold of what God is saying. And in verse 41, it says, now Jesus sat opposite the treasury. And see, that right there is a revelation. The fact that God is looking at what we give. Not only is he looking at what we give, he's also looking at when we give, where we give, and how we give. How many of you know that? And see, one of the things, you know what, I've been, Todd had this word for us when he was here that we had received more from Oral Roberts than we knew. And honestly, Todd didn't even really know in the natural a lot of our connection with Dr. Oral and just the history there. But it had me go back and really start restudying the principle of seed time and harvest. Some of you know understand seed time and harvest, that a harvest, that a seed reproduces after its own kind. And when you look at a seed, it's not just what you sow, your seed, but how many of you know it's also when you sow it? You can sow good seed at the wrong time and it not produce the harvest you're believing for. But not only is it important what we sow and when we sow, but also where we sow. Because you can sow a great seed at a great time in the wrong place and it not yield the harvest you're believing for. Amen. Matthew 13 talks about the different types of soil, the different conditions of our heart, and talks about what produces 30, 60, and 100-fold in our life. And so there's the what, there's the when, there's the where, but also there is the how. And that's what we see here with this widow and with the two mites. It was not just what she gave, but the how, the heart behind her gift. So Jesus sat opposite the treasury and saw how the people put money into the treasury, and many who were rich put in much. Isn't that awesome? He sat opposite the treasury and saw how the people put money into the treasury. And honestly, sometimes we can become so used to giving, it almost can become like something we do kind of almost just out of repetition. We do it because we give because we give. How many of you know that? You know, we're giving people. We don't need to tell you why to give. You just know that, you know, God so loved that he gave, and we so love that we give. Amen? But sometimes we can actually extract or deny the power of giving freely to God what God has given to us when we get almost repetitious and we begin to remove relationship from the equation. Because sometimes our giving can be more of a religion than a relationship. And one of the things a friend of our house says, Bob Hazlitt, is religion is anything we do for God, absent of relationship with God. And see, what you see here with this widow, of course you see it in the life of Abel, you know, as opposed to Cain, and all throughout Scripture, is there's something of giving out of relationship and revelation that not only produces a harvest, but it also moves the heart of heaven on your behalf. And so Jesus sat opposite the treasury and saw how the people put money into the treasury. How many who were rich put in much? Then one poor widow came and threw in two mites, which make a quadrants. So he called his disciples to himself and said to them, "Assuredly, I say to you that this poor widow who has put in more than all those who have given to the treasury, for they all put in out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, put in all that she had, her whole livelihood." And what happened here was she was communicating in her giving the high place in her heart that the Lord had. And even as we talked about, whether it be in the food ministry, the clothing ministry, or other things that we do, whatever we do to the least of these or whatever we do in his name, we're really doing unto him. The same thing is true in terms of giving in a way that costs us, not offering to the Lord something that hasn't cost us. Isn't that what David said? And so tonight, as we receive our offering, I want you to give as the Lord leads you tonight, okay? I don't want you just to give because you're used to giving. I want you to allow the Lord to touch your heart as to what he would have you do tonight. Because the blessing on our life is willingness and obedience to do what God says, when he says to do it, where he says to do it, and how he tells us to do it. Does that make sense? So if you're making out checks tonight, you can make them out to Kingsway Church. If you want to get by cash or credit card, there's envelopes in the seat pocket in front of you. And while you're praying about what the Lord would have you to do tonight, I do want to go ahead and just welcome to my real good friends who are here with us tonight and tell them they need to come up front and sit with me tonight because I'm just excited they're here. Chris and Shelby Adams, can you guys go ahead and stand on up? This is Chris and Shelby Adams. Can we thank the Lord for these guys? These are just good friends of ours. We're getting to know more and more. Y'all come on up. I want y'all to sit with me up here. And Shelby is also pregnant, due any day, with Ada Adams. I said it right. Ada? Is that right? All right, good. Ada Adams. And also, Rachel Barrett just announced, Rachel Medores just announced that she is pregnant. Let's thank the Lord for that. Baby's popping out everywhere. Come on now. And how many of you know that's a sign in the natural of what God is doing in the spirit to conceive and to birth the things of God. And so, I mean, that's New Testament church growth right there, being fruitful and multiply. Come on, Jesus. So, amen. Everybody got your gift in your hand? Go ahead and stand up with me tonight. Let's pray for you. Thank you, Jesus. And again, I want to thank you. I really want to encourage you too. And I was talking to Eva about this the other day when we were kind of debriefing after the food packaging. It really is such a blessing. And I was talking even to Maxine about it today as we were walking around and just ministering to different folks in the church. It is such a blessing to see how far your generosity is able to go in meeting natural needs of our community and the spiritual needs of this house and this city. I would encourage you in the weeks ahead, again, our next feeding is January 5th. I would encourage you, you know, those, I know a lot of times people are working on Tuesday, so it's hard to get there. But there's something about just coming and being a part of serving. You know, this past Tuesday, my boys came, and that was the first time they got to come and serve. And they had a blast. They're like, Dad, when can we go back and do this? They, along with Joseph and Ryan and the others, where they were in charge of the shopping carts. They were running shopping carts back and forth. And it's days like that, it's moments like these, that the truth that it is better to give than to receive speaks loudly in our hearts. Amen? Let's go ahead and hold our offerings up. Father, we just thank you so much, Lord, for the generosity that you have released to this house, the generosity releasing through this house, and the generosity coming into this house, even in this next now season. Father God, we thank you for a season of abundance, overflow, and fruitfulness for each and every family and each and every house represented here tonight and those watching on by way of the web. And Father, it is with thankful hearts that we freely give back to you of what you have so freely given to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on forward and let's minister to the Lord in our giving tonight. That you've allowed this house to do in so little time through your faithfulness and the generosity of our people. God, we thank you. You said that your people will volunteer willingly in the day of your power and that we are in the days of your power. God, we thank you, Jesus, for everything that you've done, everything that you're doing, everything you've promised to do. In Jesus' name. Hey, can we do this? Can we go ahead and welcome James Rodgers to come up and speak to us tonight? Come on, James. As James is making it, hey, and can we just thank the Lord for Steve and for Aaron and for Corey and for Dave? Aren't these guys amazing? So awesome. You know, James and I, we were spending some time together, just having lunch. I guess it was like 2 weeks ago, and just hearing what God is doing in his heart, just so amazing. And then Todd and I were having breakfast, over there on, what was it, East 59, is that what they call it? And part of the reason I wanted to take him there is because I had a feeling you'd walk in. And so James walks in and just begins to start talking about what God is doing in his life. And I said, man, I said, this is so encouraging. How many of you know living waters come out of the innermost being? And, so I was meeting with somebody today. In fact, it was Maxine. And I just said, Maxine, I just want to put a spigot in you and let the syrup of the deep begin to flow out. And it was just awesome. There's something about these opportunities to where we can just let the Lord put that tap and allow the living waters to come out of our innermost being. And so I want to encourage you as you receive tonight to be refreshed, to be encouraged, to be challenged, and stretch your hands out to James. Father, we just thank you for James. God, we thank you for Jenny. God, we thank you for Gracious, and we thank you for everything that you're doing in and through their life, God. And we celebrate who they are and what you're doing in them. And so, Father, we thank you for your anointing. God, we thank you, Holy Spirit, for everything you've placed in his heart for him to share tonight. And in Jesus' name, we just speak grace to let it all out. Amen.
We love you.
Hey, everybody. I'm really excited and honored to get to talk to all of y'all. First of all, I'm really excited and honored just to be a part of this group. This is the first time I get to talk to all of you together, and I'm just excited and honored that God would ask me to be a part of this group of people, because I know so many of us just have such a deep and rich relationship with the Holy Spirit, and I'm just honored that you're listening to me for a second. This is kind of, Jeff almost started touching on this. I love coming out of deception. Does anyone else love coming out of deception? It's very humbling to say to God and to someone else, I was completely wrong. I thought I knew all this stuff, and it was all wrong. It's just such a humbling and refreshing thing to just receive truth and be able to say, all that stuff I thought I knew, it's just, doesn't matter. Jesus matters. Yeah. So I'm just going to share a little bit of a deception that I came out of and what the truth really is and what it looks like to live it out. And whether or not I say everything right, I just ask you to listen to the Holy Spirit, and not so much the words that I say, but the spirit of what I want to give to you. And I feel like really the spirit of what I want to give to you is just the invitation from the Father to just step out, to really desire to see the things of the kingdom in our everyday lives, to an invitation to just let go of the image that we sometimes try to hold on to or what people think of us, just an invitation to just let go of all that and just passionately go after displaying the kingdom in our lives. So that's really just what I want to impart to you through all the stuff I say. Because that's what me and the Holy Spirit have been talking about in the last couple weeks. I've been in this place where I'm realizing I have all these things that I say that I believe. I believe that Jesus is the healer, and I believe that he paid for us to live abundant life, and I believe that he's the desire of the nations, but what does my life say that I believe? Like, I believe that it's time for revival. I really believe it's time. Like, that's one thing I just wanted to say. I really feel like it's time. Not just saying that. I really feel like it's time for us to walk in who we're supposed to be. It's really time for the fire and the kingdom to be displayed in Birmingham. I believe that, and I say that, and I want my life to say it. I want people who don't know me and who don't see me in this building, what I do in this building, to see in my life what I believe. You know? So I've just felt this invitation from the Holy Spirit for my life to display what I believe, for the two to converge, because you confess the things and you exercise your faith, but I want my life to say it just as much as my mouth does. So I'll go ahead and like really humble myself and share a story. I was telling Jason about this moment I had, I think like 2 Sundays ago. This isn't the kind of testimony that we want to hear a lot of the time, but just to kind of display a position of the heart, I had woken up early this Sunday morning. It was like 7 o'clock, and I was running to the coffee shop to have some time just to read my Bible and have some me time. And the coffee shop, that one, it was closed on Sunday. And so I was like, bummer. And I ran over and stopped by Publix just to get a couple things for breakfast that morning. And as I came up to the register, there was a guy in front of me. He looked about my age, and he had his hood up, and I heard him talking to the cashier, and she was just kind of shaking his head, and I heard him say something about, "I just got out of the hospital, please," and she just like shook her head, and he kind of limped out and stood right outside the door. And so I'm like, And I get my stuff and I walk out and I'm thinking like, man, he really needs to be healed. He just like fell down, and I was like, this would be a really awesome time to display the kingdom, and just to be honest and man, it's humbling, but I just kind of checked out. Just kind of said, man, I was planning on going home and doing this and. Just gonna go, and I just walked to my car, guys. And that's not what my life looked like in previous years with Jesus, and it's not what we're called to live like. But in that moment, that's how my heart responded, and that happened once or twice a few weeks ago. And I was like, man, this is not me. This isn't. That's not how we're supposed to respond. I didn't look at him and see him the way that Jesus saw him, because I would have spent any amount of time on him had I saw him the way that Jesus saw him. But I was just, so I was getting really, really honest with the Holy Spirit and saying, man, what do I believe and what is my life saying? So I think that kind of stemmed from this deception I was going to tell you about. It came through, first of all, the finished work of the cross. What Jesus did on the cross. He said, it is finished. And that's an extremely powerful statement. It is finished. It's very important for me, I know, to define what was finished. We can't just say, it is finished, and mosey around and you know, just go through life saying, well, it's finished. It's really important to know what was finished. Our identity was finished. Forever, we are the sons and daughters of God. Forever, we are declared righteous. We have been, you know, we stand in Christ. We stood before the throne, and forever, for all of eternity, we're judged righteous. It's finished. Our identity is set, and there's nothing we could ever do to become more righteous or to become closer to the Father. There's nothing we could ever do to change how he sees us or to earn more favor in his eyes. Forever, it is finished. Our identity, our righteousness is set in stone in Christ. We can't change it. We can't get more of our identity. It's just who we are now. It's finished. Also, it's finished. We get the Holy Spirit. My wife has this really, really powerful message in her spirit about the finished work of the cross is sufficient for you to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The price Jesus paid, the blood he shed, the newness he raised us up into makes us fully able to receive the Holy Spirit and no less. You either get the Holy Spirit or you don't. There's not a junior Holy Spirit and then the master Holy Spirit. You know, there's no initial Holy Spirit and then you have more once you go to ministry school. Like, when you get the Holy Spirit, you get the Spirit that raised Christ from the dead. So it's finished. Who I am will never change in God's eyes. I can't get closer to him. I can't get further away from him because I'm his son. And forever he's welcomed us in. So all of that is really powerful, but what Jeff kind of touched on for a second, and that I kind of drifted off into for like a couple years ago, is just head knowledge. You know, there's a difference between facts and truth, because truth is a person. Jesus said, "I am the truth." So if we spend all of our time just dwelling, thinking, logically going through thought processes about it's finished, the devil can kind of start to use truths but make them half truth if we just stay in the head knowledge realm of things that God tells us, because he doesn't tell us it so that we can just know everything and go about our lives. He tells us so we can know it and live in relationship with him. So I started living in a lot of head knowledge about the finished work of cross, that I have all of the Holy Spirit. I have, you know, I can't get any better. These are, I'm going to start saying, like, kind of half-truths. I'm not going to continue preaching the truth. Like, I have the fullness of the Holy Spirit. I don't need to ask for anything else. Like, I need to just spend more time resting and just kind of relaxing I was kind of afraid of getting into works. Fear is never good. Fear is bad. Let's see, Holy Spirit. So anyway, you just have to look at the fruit of your life. Really dwelling on this head knowledge, lots of thinking, lots of analyzing, lots of even arguing a little bit about what we do have to do and what we don't have to do. All that mattered was I started to be able to look at my life and see, man, all this stuff about, like, I don't really need to do anything anymore. It doesn't translate to a broken, hurting world. The whole mindset of I can chill out because it's finished. It doesn't have anything to offer to someone who has just lost the most important person in their life, or someone who is, their church just got burned down by ISIS. It doesn't have anything to offer to someone who is standing outside of Publix thinking that they don't have anyone who cares about them and needs someone to pray for them. So really it translates into, yeah, I do have the fullness of the Holy Spirit. Okay. This is where me and I got to share with Todd how much he's blessed me since he's been coming. I just received permission through him coming and releasing what he had, that, yeah, we do have all of the Holy Spirit, but what do I see in my life and what do I want to see in my life? And God, I'm just going to be humble and say, I think that I know all this stuff, but what my life says is more powerful than what my mouth says. And I'm just going to be humble and say, I want to display your kingdom. I want to live like Jesus lived. And all of these thoughts that are floating around in my head that sound true, I don't think I'm seeing fruit in my life. I need to know truth. I just need to know truth. I need to know Jesus. And whatever's right and wrong intellectually, just throw it out the window. I want to know Jesus because he's truth. And, yeah, like, soak and be anchored in the Bible, because you'll never go wrong there. I'm not saying, like, intellect is bad. Our brains are really, really good. Our thoughts are really, really good. God wants to redeem every one of them and have every one of our thoughts and intellectual moments be holy and redeemed. But just laying it all down and saying, it doesn't matter what I know or what I don't know. It doesn't matter what I think I have learned up to this point. I just want to see the kingdom in my life. I want to see someone and think and feel the way that you do when I see them. So just freedom from head knowledge. It's really, really good. And by the way, I just want to just kind of wrap it up with this, that I'm talking about the convergence of what we believe and what we live. The two need to be the same. And just for the record, what I believe is that this outpouring, this revival, time of refreshing, more people coming to know Jesus in our city, in our state, I really feel like the container of it, what I believe, I feel like the container for this coming revival is the normal Christian life. I feel like this past week, I've been hearing the Holy Spirit say crazy stuff, and he talks to me in such a way. I'm a pep talk kind of guy. I'm like a need a slap on the butt kind of guy. Just come on. That's the kind of encouragement I like. So if it's not my wife's type of encouragement. She likes, like, you're awesome, like an affirmation. I like challenge. The Holy Spirit said to me, you know what would be worse than spending 40 years in a secular job that you're not really passionate about? You know what would be worse about going to the same place every day and not doing a ministry something? That's a wrong thought anyway, but you know what would be worse than going somewhere and not, like, doing something 8 hours a day that you're really passionate about? What would be worse than that would be sitting next to someone for 40 years and them not knowing that the Spirit that raised Christ from the dead was in you. And I'm just, like, so humble. I'm just, like, so humble and saying, God, I just throw my image out the window. Just throw my schedule out the window. Throw my agenda out the window. Throw the things that I think I know out the window. And just let your kingdom be manifest in my life. Like, let the fullness of the Holy Spirit that I got from Jesus be manifest. That's it. Like, I just bless you guys. Thank you so much.
You know, here's really, you know, I mean, so much of this is being, you know, not leaning on the knowledge about God, but really walking in the knowledge of God. Amen? You know, Jesus said in John 17:3, he said, we talk about eternal life being the going to heaven when we die, but Jesus said in John 17:3, eternal life is knowing the Father and the Son whom he sent. And you can always tell, someone's vertical relationship of worship always shows in their horizontal relationship with people. People who are passionate about God become passionate about people. People who love God and know God's love. Because there's a lot of people who love God. But when you really know the love of Father for you, you then freely give that love away. Amen? And you're no longer living on the defensive. You're living on the offensive. You're no longer trying to maintain what you got. You're trying to take back ground from darkness. And so as James was sharing, how many of you said, that's me. I found myself in a Publix parking lot a time or two looking and seeing somebody. And then, here's the real fun one. All of a sudden, you see someone coming your direction that you know is in need of the kingdom, amen, in need of the touch of Christ, and you do this. Maybe if they don't see me, see them, I don't have to do anything. You know? We laugh because it's true. But if you've been in that place and you say, you know what, I want to make the decision that James made to where I'm not going to turn away from need, I'm not going to turn away from an opportunity, but I want the grace to turn to. I want the grace to see different, that when I look at people, I don't see what's wrong and go, oh, no. I look at them and go, oh, yeah. Because there's something about recognizing Christ in you, the hope of glory, that when you see someone in need of the touch of God in their life, you get excited. It's like a pit bull pouncing on some meat. Amen? Because you're like, oh yeah, God's about to show up. And so I really believe that God is wanting to replace negative expectation with positive expectancy. Amen. And so if that's you tonight, just stand up, and I'm going to ask James just to pray over you because he has authority. You know, when God is working this thing in our heart, we have authority to begin to speak it and release it to others. So again, if you've been in a place where you say, man, listen, I've just been timid. My life is not lining up with what I say I believe. Just stand up right now and just be bold about it. Be bold about it. I'm standing. I want my life to look more like what I believe. I don't want to just quote a verse. I want to be the word. Amen. Release it, James.
And just you judge the tree by its fruit. But you can judge that the tree that I'm talking about is good because yesterday I was at Publix and just walking through the produce section, and there was this gentleman putting up onions, and I felt like I should talk to him, and I said, hi, what's your name? I'm James. And he said, I'm Darren. And I said, hey, Darren, hope you're doing great. And I'm just like, that was it. I didn't feel anything other than saying hi to him. And I'm walking down another aisle, and I feel like, oh, man, I think I should go prophesy to him. I don't know what. I didn't have anything in my head, but I just had this feeling. And I said, you know, I got laid out at that conference. Jesus has been really pounding me to show his kingdom. I don't have anything right now, but it's time. Like, so I walked over there, and as I spoke to him, I just said, kind of like Bob was saying at Power and Love, I just feel like you're the kind of person who, and just let it out. And this has never happened to me for someone to respond like this, but he kind of said, whoa, that relates to so much of what he's investing his life in right now, and you're either here in the Holy Spirit or you're in the CIA or something like that. And he just was like really encouraged. So I just wanted to end it on a positive note. Like, Publix is awesome now. So, Father, we just believe that you want to display your kingdom through us. Lord, we believe that you give grace to the humble, and it's only through grace that we display your power and your works. So we humble ourselves, Lord. We just willingly just throw aside, we count it as rubbish, all the things that we valued up until we came to know you. Our reputation, our intellect, all the knowledge that we've built up, God, we just say it's rubbish compared to knowing Christ. And Lord, we just want to give ourselves more to your expression in our city. Lord, we want to give ourselves fully to your agenda, to your time schedule, to your priorities, Lord. And I just confess that anything not born out of your heart is just going to fade away and die. Anything that doesn't come out of your heart is just going to die, and it's a waste of time. We just want to live out of your heart. We just want to display what's in your heart. We just want to manifest your kingdom and your glory, Lord. And we just want to even more belong to you. So can we just ask to even more than yesterday, no matter where we're at, to belong to you more, for more of our life to be yours. You're just everything. We love you. So blessings. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Well, come on up, Paige Honey Jackson. Come on now. How many of you enjoyed that? Wasn't that awesome? Encouraging? You know, and James honestly gave a wonderful practical piece. Some of you heard that when he just went up. He didn't have anything. He didn't have some sort of angelic encounter, some sort of open vision. He just had a desire to speak life to this young man. And so he walked up and he said, you know what? You know, when I looked at you, I saw, you know. And honestly, you know, Maxine and I are walking around today just prophesying over everything that maybe we had just an awesome time. And it was just so great. Sometimes you just got to walk up. You don't wait for a word and then walk up. Sometimes you walk up and then the word comes. Amen? And so you just put a demand on that. So I want to encourage you just to step up and step out and see what God does. Amen? Paige Jackson.
I think they've all preached my message, so. Well, I'm just glad to be here. I think Jeff has mentioned part of my message, and Jason has mentioned part of my message, and I was like, this is good, confirmation. So Jason texted me, I don't know if it was today or yesterday, we were talking about faith, and I was telling him I was going to speak on faith, and he said, that's awesome. I believe that. And then he said, I just pulled up into a parking lot, and on the back of this car is this, their tag says faith. I was like, awesome. You know, that's what we need. We need confirmation in our lives. And I just love this church. We've only been here a short time, but I just love all you. I don't know you. But I you know, you're, with my heart, I just love you. And the ones that I do know, I've really come to love, even just for a short time. And it's just amazing to have a church where you feel the presence of God when you walk in the door. And, you know, every time we tell somebody about the church, we say, you feel the presence of God when you walk in the door. And I'm like, really? And we do tell people that. So anyway, today I've been preaching to my cat. Yeah. And Annabelle. And Jason's prayed for Annabelle. In fact, it's funny, when we first, a couple weeks ago, Annabelle had to have surgery. And so Jason texts me, and I'm in the doctor's office with Annabelle, and he didn't know I was in there. You know, he just texts me and says, how you doing, girl? I'm like, not too good. You know, I love my cat, you know. So anyway, so I thought, well, that's pretty amazing. So then she had to have surgery that day. She had bladder stones, and she's good. And the next Sunday, he says, how's Annabelle? I'm like, you remember a cat's name? You know, that's amazing. That's amazing. He can remember people's names, cat's name. So it's just good to know people love that, love cats and people. But today, I was telling Jason, I felt like there's been a lot of warfare going on. I don't know if you felt it, but we felt it a little bit. And, you know, David and I just love each other, but there's a little warfare every now and then, you know. But the Bible says we don't wrestle with flesh and blood, but powers and principalities and rulers of darkness in high places. And so I told him I was going to pray some binding and loosing prayers. Because, and if you agree with that, you just like, get it. Say, I just take that. I'm going to, you know, I'm just bind it with me. And if I leave off anything you need to bind, just later bind it. Or while I'm talking, you can bind it, whatever. Because I feel like because it's on my heart, it was on his heart, it's really what God wants. So I'm going to do that first. And the Bible says about binding and loosing, Matthew 16:19. And then it says it again in Matthew 18:18. It says in Matthew 16:19, it says, I give you the keys of the kingdom. So whatsoever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. And another translation says, I give you the kingdom, keys of the kingdom. Whatever you bind on earth is already bound in heaven. Whatever you loose is already loosed in heaven. And it's like Todd said, we already have all these things in heaven. We can have them here. But a lot of times you have to bind the enemy to get them. Or bind whatever your reference is to get them. You know, whatever you're thinking to get them. Because they don't. Sometimes they just don't fall on you. You know, the money you need just doesn't fall on you. Because there's some resistance or something else. You know, you have to bind the thing that's hindering that. So then it says it in two places, in two different places. And now the second one in Matthew 18:18 does not say, I give you the keys of the kingdom, but it says, whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever you loose is loosed in heaven already. So when I bind things, I'm going to bind things, I'm going to loose things. So you just grab them and we'll go from there. So remember, it's the wickedness in high places we're fighting against. And first of all, I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to do that, if you don't mind. Everybody want to do that? Yeah. Okay. So, Father, I just put the armor on us. I put the helmet of salvation on everybody here and the breastplate of righteousness, our families, our children, those watching on the web. I put the helmet of salvation and the breastplate of righteousness and the shield of faith and the sword of the Spirit. And I gird our loins with your truth, and our feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Amen. And I cover this place, this whole grounds, and our families, and these people watching, and the people that are here normally that belong to this body, with the blood of Jesus. And I say, no evil shall befall us. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. So right now I bind fear, and I lose peace. In Jesus' name, I bind poverty, and I loose abundance and wealth. I bind the effects of words and curses over us. from generations past and even today and yesterday and this week. Amen. And I loose Jesus and what he's saying about us. The words that he says about us is loose to us in Jesus' name, because it's a decree from heaven, from Jesus about us. I bind wrong thinking and deception from us and all those watching. And I loose right thinking to us. We have the mind of Christ. I bind doubt and unbelief, and I loose ever-increasing faith to us. Not just faith, ever-increasing faith. We all have a measure of faith. I'm loosing ever-increasing faith. There's always faith in heaven. We have it here on the earth. We take it. I bind up any strife from ourselves, in our bodies, in our minds, in our spirits, in our homes, in this church. In Jesus' name, those watching on the web, you can have that. I bind up strife and I lose peace. In the name of Jesus, that is in heaven and harmony. And harmony. Harmony's, you got peace and harmony is better. Peace and harmony go together. In Jesus' name. So I just say those things are done. Anything in your mind that's disrupting your life later, anything that's come against you, you can bind that thing, it says. It's a tool. God gives you the keys to do that. He gives you the key. So let's use it. Let's use that tool. And, you know, sometimes I wander around myself and, well, I don't know why this is happening. I don't know why I feel like that. You know, it's just the enemy coming against your mind, trying to make you feel defeated. When you're victorious, the Bible says we triumph in Christ Jesus. And we are all here in Christ Jesus, in Christ. You know, we're standing in him. He's in us. And so, you know, we have all the tools we need. He gives us the tools. So I am going to teach on faith. But Sunday we left the church and we went out to eat. And we went in this restaurant. And we go there quite often. There's a lady in the back, you know, dishing up food. I heard her say, I woke up this morning and I said, I ain't got no doubt. I was like, well, that's good. Because that's what I was going to teach on, was faith. So I said, okay, I ain't got no doubt. And so then I got my spoon, my fork, and my silverware, and I looked down and there was a seed in my spoon. You know, somebody had, it wasn't clean. There was a seed. I was like, God, there's a seed in my spoon. And, of course, I didn't use it, but there's a seed there, and I'm like, well, a seed. I love to talk about seeds. So, you know, doubt and unbelief is the biggest thing that the devil will use to keep you from prospering, whatever God wants to do, keep you from your destiny, keep you back. You know, you go forward, two steps forward, three steps back. It's because doubt and unbelief come against you because, I mean, it's just a prevalent thing in the world. We've got a river of doubt and unbelief in this earth, in America, all over the place. And it's just flowing, and we just kind of get in the tide and go, you know, all over the place with the doubt and unbelief. And we have the Word. We have the Word that tells us how to live and tells us what we have. So for years, I lived like that. Doubt and unbelief, fear. I've talked to you about that before. Anxiety, self-pity. You know, I say I wasn't addicted to drugs, but I was addicted to self-pity. And selfishness, and all those things that are, you know, they can keep you down all your life, just like drugs or anything else. So it reminds me of a movie, Groundhog Day. Yeah, you feel like you're going, I hate that movie. But, you know, I saw part of it the other day. Then they made a Christmas movie with the same premises, where the girl gets up every morning and she's going through the same. I'm like, oh, I hate this. Because it's like going around the mountain, you know. Have you ever been around the mountain for years? Same old mountain. Same old mountain. Well, it's because of doubt and unbelief usually. Well, I can't do that. I want to be a nurse, but I've had it in my heart forever, but I can't do that. You know, I know a man that went back to school at 60 and became a nurse. You know, I mean, if God wants you to do something and it's in your heart forever, like it was in my heart to write this book for 20 years, and I kept saying, no, I'm not supposed to write. And I get all these words about writing, and I go, no. You know, if it's in your heart, then he might want you to do it. You know, it might be really something you're supposed to do for the people on the earth. And so the Bible says that faith, you need ever-increasing faith. I talked about that. Fred Price is on TV. He has a whole ministry called Ever-Increasing Faith, and it's all about faith. If you ever noticed, the faith teachers usually were healed of something. Yeah, they were. Every one of them. There's one in Adamsville, I think he lived, or Summerton, Tommy Combs. I mean, they're all healed. I mean, they're healed of something dramatic, and so they go, wow, you know, grab it, just like me. I was healed of terminal disease, and so faith is a big major thing in my life, even though I kind of get out of it every now and then, just like everybody else. So faith, like the seed in my spoon, is what we every day, the things that we speak are seeds in our life. They're seeds. They're either good containers or they're bad containers. And, you know, the Bible says to choose how you will live. In Deuteronomy 30, it says he puts his word in your mouth. Choose this day how you will live. I set before you life and death. Wow. Life and death is a big deal. Right. You know, if you want life, then you need to choose that by the words you say, which, you know, we all mess up and say the wrong things. But then you could say, Lord, I didn't mean that. I meant this one. I meant this in the Bible. Right here. You know, he knows how serious you are. You know, if you mess up, it's all right. So in Jeremiah 15, Jeremiah said that he ate the word. Well, I feel like there's times in my life I've eaten the word. I know Jason has. I mean, my friend Mitty and Shelley, they eat the word. You know, it's like the word is so alive to you. It is alive. The Bible says it's alive. But we don't normally, I was not taught that it was alive. It wasn't really life. When you spoke it, it didn't create life. I wasn't taught that. But when you speak it, it creates life. When I spoke it to my body over and over and over that by the stripes of Jesus I was healed, it created life in me. And so my body had to line up with that. So when I spoke over my children that they hungered and thirsted after God, it created life in them. Took a while, but then I saw it. It was reality. So we want to see reality now. We want to see miracles now. I was telling today the Lord, I like miracles fast. You know, Oral Roberts said there's miracles in one of his books passing you all the time, and you just don't know they're there, and you don't reach out and get them. And we don't look for miracles. We don't expect miracles. Now, I want to expect miracles more. Now, we do want to see people healed quickly. We want to see them healed now. And if there's a line of somebody's anointed like Jason or somebody in here that's anointed for healing, I'm going to be in that line. I want it now. But if not, I'm going to stand on the word. And, you know, usually it's I'm going to stand on the word, you know. And even if you're healed, what happens? You walk out the door, that little pain hits you again. I just wasn't healed. It was gone for 10 minutes, but I just know that was my imagination or, you know. Then you take the word, and you get to the word, and you get all those verses. I've got them in my book if you want it. You can pull them up on the internet, I'm sure. There's a lot of healing scriptures on the internet. You can find them in your Bible. You know, I thought about attending to the word. This is one of my favorite verses. Proverbs 4:20-23 says, to attend to my word, incline your ears to my sayings. Do not let them depart out of your eyes. Keep them in the midst of your heart, for their life to your bones and health to all your flesh. I mean, how important is the word? You know, it's everything. You know, the doctors may tell you something that's a fact, like Jeff said, but the word is the truth. Yeah, the word is the truth. So if the doctor says you got this or that, then you go, well, what does the word say? The word says he bore every sickness for us and carried every disease. The word says that all his blood was shed for us on the cross, and at that point we were healed. At that point we were healed. So just like we were saved at that point, we receive our healing at that point. So we have to walk that out. So what do you do when you attend? It's like you tend to a garden. You water it. You pull the weeds. So if anything comes up when it tries to steal the word from you, as the Bible says, you cast that thing down. It says cast down those imaginations. When that thing comes up against your mind and said, well, I'm never going to prosper. Well, the Bible says he wishes above all things that you prosper, that you be in good health. That's two things. Even as your soul prospers. If there's something in your soul that isn't prospering, just repent. Get it out of there. the Bible says that the word is like fire. Jeremiah 5:14. The word is like fire. There's life and death in the power of the tongue. There's another life and death, the scripture. You know, we don't take that literally, but you can speak life into a situation that looks deadly in your life. You can speak life into your marriage and refuse to let the enemy steal from you. You refuse. You have authority in that marriage. You have authority in that child's life if they're going off this way. You have authority over that sickness. Now, it may not happen that day. It may not happen the next day. I know I prayed for one of my sons for 6 years, and I told you about it in the book. And I'd go in the bathroom and cry and go, "Oh God, he's a godly man." I'd come out, and he'd say something ugly. I'd go, "Oh God, he's a godly man." And, you know, you just keep in there and saying the truth, because the word says you have authority in your family. You have authority to bless your children. The Bible says in John 15:7, if you abide in me and my what?
My word
abides in you, you will have what you, you can ask what you will. You can ask what you will. I mean, you know, you just rip that thing out of this Bible. You know, I say, what do they do with all these scriptures that says you can have what you ask for? You know, I'm reminded of Kenneth Hagin. Some of y'all know Kenneth Hagin's testimony, but I just love to read about Kenneth Hagin. I loved it. Hear his voice, even. You know, he's just got this great voice. And, you know, he said when he was a little Baptist boy, he was dying of three diseases. He knew one scripture, Mark 11:24. Whatever you ask in my name, you will receive. Whatever you ask, you will receive. Well, that's pretty simple, but nobody believes it. Not many people. We believe it. You and me, we believe it. But whatever you ask in my name, you will receive. So Kenneth Hagin got a hold of that scripture, and he was dying of like a lung disease. No, it was a blood disease, heart disease, and he was paralyzed. Okay, that's pretty desperate. And, you know, three things. It's not just one thing. It's like, you know, and his pastor comes in and tells him, well, it's okay. You're going to die soon. And he goes, well, what about this verse? This says, whatever you ask, believe, and you shall receive. And he says, well, it's okay. You don't worry about it now. You just don't worry about it, you know. And so Kenneth just kept saying, well, what about this verse? What about this verse? So he began to pray that verse. And he said, Lord, I believe that. I believe it. And the Lord said, not yet. Not yet. But I said, whatever you said, whatever I believe, I receive, and I believe. And the Lord said, not yet. He just kept praying. And he didn't die. And the Lord said one day, yes, it's now. You believe. And when he really, see, we have to get it from here down into here. And the way we do that is we get into the word. We speak the word. You know, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And when I was healed, I had to speak it. I mean, I'd speak it under my breath because nobody else wanted to hear it. So I'd be like, by the stripes of Jesus, I am healed. By the stripes of Jesus, I am healed. You know, and I would speak it to myself and in the closet, in the bathroom when I was able to walk, wherever I was. And I would speak it out loud because I wanted to hear it. I wanted to hear it. You know, I was thirsty. I was hungry for it because I was desperate. Some of us have not been that desperate. Some of us are desperate, and we need to do that with our children. I don't care what it is. I don't care what comes up. You know, the word is life if you speak it into that situation. So Kenneth was healed. There's another, y'all may have not heard this one, but he had an eye problem. And he was like 19, I guess. Little Baptist boy, he said. But he knew God would heal then, so he went to a tent revival, and he goes in, and he sits down on a row, and he's like on the end of the row, and the pastor says, now, when I come down the row, I'm going to lay hands on you, and you will be healed, because the Bible says, lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover, in James. So Kenneth is sitting there. The pastor comes down. Nobody's slain in the spirit. Nobody's jumping up and down, jumping to poos or anything. But he just gets up, walks out. So a girl meets him outside. She said, Kenneth, how are your eyes? Well, they're healed. Really? Let me see. I guess you could see it. And she said, they don't look healed. He said, but they are. She said, well, let's go show my grandmother. So they're walking. It's a little back in the probably 30s. I don't know. So dirt road. They're walking down the middle of the town on a dirt road. They get to her grandmother's house. And it's like one of these houses that has a light bulb hanging down the middle of the room, you know. So the grandmother says, let me see your eyes, Kenneth. So she turns the light on. She said, they don't look healed. He said, but they are. So they go out in the street, and the girl says, well, Kenneth, they're walking down the street. Well, how do you know they're healed? Well, the man said, when he laid hands on me, the Bible says I would be recovered. It says in James, and so when he laid hands on me, I was healed. And at that moment, he was healed just like that. Because he grabbed the word. And I mean, the word was life to him, and he knew then, because he had prayed before, whatever I ask, believe, and I shall receive. He knew then that the word was life to him. So when you're standing on the word, it's an active thing. You say, somebody says, I'm just standing on the word. Oh, what are you doing while you're standing? You know, when you're standing on the word, it's, you got to put activation into that. You know, you find some scriptures to stand on. It's not like you have to just worry over them. You just thank the Lord it's already done. If you've prayed those scriptures, you just begin to thank him. Lord, I thank you that I'm healed. I thank you that we're prosperous. I thank you that we have that car we need. I thank you that our bank account is full because we tithe and we give and the windows of heaven are open, pouring blessings out on us. We don't have room enough to receive. I thank you, Lord, that my children are walking with you because they belong to me and I prayed for them and I believe for them. You know, you just begin to thank the Lord. That's standing. Standing is not, oh, well, you know, God will do what he wants to do. I'm just standing on the word. Well, the word is active and powerful. So one time, talking about seed, years ago, I don't know if you know who Joe and Sharon Ward are, but we didn't know them. They're a little different. And so so we go, they use props when they minister to people. You know them, Jason? Yeah. So they, you know, we go to this meeting and they call us up and we're like, okay. So Joe gets out duct tape and he puts it on my mouth and he puts it on David's mouth and he said, you're tearing up your seed with your words. I thought, that can't be true. I'm the most word-spoken people I know, you know. David's the one that tears up the word. You know, it's him. So about 3 years later, they don't know us. That we know them well now. They've been at our house. But 3 years later, we go to another meeting. They don't really know us. They call us up, get out the duct tape. I'm like, I can't believe it. Again, we're still tearing up our words? It's like you don't realize. You don't have to be, like, worried about your words. But you just have to, you know, say, Lord, I want to say the right things that line up with the truth. I don't want my seed to be stolen by the devil, because that's what he wants to do. He wants to steal your seed that you're speaking over your life, whether it's you want to be, have a baby or get married, or some of you want lots of things you've given up on. You need to believe again and say, I'm believing again.
Yeah.
You know, it didn't work out 2 or 3 years ago, but I'm believing again because the Bible says this is a desire of my heart and I delight myself in him. So the Bible says in Job 22:28, we shall decree a thing. It is established for us, and the light of his favor shines on our way. So what are you decreeing? What are you declaring with your words? Your life needs to line up, just like the young man that spoke. Your life needs to line up with the truth. Your words need to line up with the truth. Ask the Lord to show you how to do that. I've got one more example. I got two more examples. Did y'all care? I had a dream years ago. Now, I have an Aunt Bernice. I did. She's in heaven. But she lived in the hills of Tennessee, and I'd spend the night with her sometimes. And I had a dream about her house one time. Now, she was in the Eastern Star. Do you know what the Eastern Star is? It's a Masonic order thing. My daddy was a 32nd degree Mason, which is not a good thing. And I've broken all that, all those curses, you know. I don't even know what the curses are, but I broke them anyway. You know, we have the lineage of Jesus. We don't have the lineage of the Masonic Lodge. And we're not taking that lineage. My kids aren't taking that lineage. My grandchildren, we're free from all that stuff. Anyway, my aunt was in the Eastern Star, and she had this star on her wall that was about this big, and I used to get the creeps walking by. But so I had a dream about her house one time, and I dreamed I was in her kitchen, and the doors in her kitchen cabinets, they would just open and close, just slam, open and close. And then there were candles that would flame up and get down, a flame up, and I knew it was the devil in the dream. And I'd say to the cabinet doors, and I'd say to the flame, stop that in the name of Jesus. Stop that in the name of Jesus. And it didn't stop. So I kept saying, stop that. I said about four times in the dream, stop that in the name of Jesus. And then I said, okay, I'm going to get out. I'm going to get the word out, and I'm going to say the word to you. So I opened the Bible in the dream, and I said, okay, I'm going to say the word to you. As soon as I opened the Bible, the flames went flat, and the door shut in the dream. Because in Psalms, let's see, I wrote it down here. It says in Psalms 138:2 says, he magnifies his word above his name. And I did not even know that verse. When I had that dream, I was like, whoa, that's, I said, oh my gosh. He magnified his word above his name. And we know his name. I mean, his name is everything. But he and his name and the word are one. And Jesus and the word are one, it says in John 1:1. And so he magnifies his word above his name. So I want to know what you're pregnant with today, besides children. Several pregnant women in here. You know, I love the story about Paul Yonggi Cho. When he was sick and dying, somebody prayed for him, and he got saved, and he got well. And then he became a pastor. He's the pastor of one of the largest churches in the world in Seoul, Korea. He's probably in his 70s, 80s, something now. But he was this young guy. I guess he was Buddhist. I don't know. But he got saved miraculously, and he became a minister. Like 15 people, and they were poor, dirt poor. But he got a hold of the word, and he looked at the word and what the word said he could have, and he was like, wow, well, let's see, I want a Bible. No, he wouldn't know he had a Bible. He said, I want a bicycle, American-made bicycle. Now, you think about it. Why would God care if anybody had an American-made bicycle or a certain kind of car? But anyway, he said to the Lord, I want an American-made bicycle. I want a mahogany desk and a chair to go with the desk. So he's praying that, believing that, and nobody taught him how to pray. He just had the word. See, he had the word. And, you know, there's not a mahogany desk or a bicycle in the word. That was just a desire of his heart. And so he's got this little church, and he tells his congregation one day, 15 people, I have a mahogany desk and a bicycle and a chair. And they're like, wow, wow, I'm so excited. They're so excited. They want to see it. And he's like, oh, no. You know, they want to see it, so they go home with him, and all the way he's going, oh, gosh, they're going to be so upset with me because they won't see it. They won't see it. And so they get to his house. He raises, it's like a garage door that he lives in, a little tiny place. He has no money. They have no money. So they, where's he going to get this? So there's nothing there, and they laugh at him. And he says, well, I really don't have it. I'm pregnant with it. I really don't have it. I'm pregnant with it. So 2 or 3 months later, he's helping this couple move, and they're loading up all their stuff in this truck. And he says, you know, they say, you know, we can't get all this stuff in the truck. We got a mahogany desk, an American-made bicycle, and a chair. And would you like to have these things? So he was pregnant with those things, and why would God care? Why would he care? I mean, he cares about sickness and disease. He cares about typhoons and tsunamis and hurricanes. Why would he care? Because he loves us. Because he loved Cho. Cho had 15 people in his church. It's not like he had a big church and was impressing people. You know what I mean? So, whatever you need, take a hold of this and be pregnant with it. What are you pregnant with? Write down what you want to be pregnant with. You know? Some of you may want to be pregnant with child. Some of you may want your daughter or son to find a husband or wife. Some of you might want a husband or wife. Whatever you need, cars, you know, God doesn't care. He's not a stingy God. If he says he opens the windows of heaven, how big is that? Pouring blessings out on you. So I'm going to pray for us tonight before we go that we would get it. Yeah. It would be manifest in our lives. So, Father, I just thank you for the opportunity to speak to these wonderful people that you love, that Jesus lives in them and he lives in me, and the Jesus in me and the Jesus in them are united and not warring against each other. And let families hear the Jesus in them and the Jesus in each other not war against each other. Let us live in peace and harmony. I pray that we would be pregnant with what you want us to be pregnant with, and that you, Lord, would give us the desires of our hearts and the desire of your heart for the earth and where we live. In Jesus' name, Amen.
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 How many of you felt just, you felt something on that binding and loosening too? I kind of feel like we need to come back and just circle around to that too, if we can. And one of the things, it's interesting, when Paige was talking about David Yonggi Cho, and there's a book called Fourth Dimension, yeah, where he talks, and many of you have read that book, okay? If you've not read it, that's where he talks about the story, and it not only was the mahogany desk, the chair, and the bicycle, but he had a bowl and he had no rice, and that was kind of where it started for him. And he would look at that bowl and he would see rice every day. And he would keep speaking out of what he saw. Because how many of you know if you say what you see, you'll see what you say. Amen? And so he just kept seeing it and believing it and birthing it. And see, what happens is Paul told the Galatians, he said that we would reap in due season if we do not lose heart. Amen? And so it's oftentimes in the speaking of the word that our heart grows weary. And when our heart grows weary, that's when we begin to pull back on the speaking of the word. And it's often just before a season called due season when we reap the harvest of the words we've spoken. Amen? Paige talked about it. Deuteronomy 30:19. He said, I hold heaven and earth as a witness against you, blessing or curses, life or death. And then he said, you choose, but choose life so you and your descendants may live. And what we see there is the same thing that God spoke to the children of Israel, God speaks to us. Amen. We are, how many of you know, we have been engrafted in. We are God's chosen people. Yes, God has a heart for Israel, but God has a heart for you too. Amen. And this is one of the things, you know, that even when Paige was telling me about Annabelle, you know, and I just asked her, I said, how's Annabelle? She goes, how can you remember that? I said, listen, I said, if it matters to you, it matters to God. And if it matters to God, it matters to me. And see, we've got to begin to recognize that God isn't just, he's a big God, but he's also all about the small stuff because it's who he is. Amen. And so one of the things that we recognize with that is a lot of times we lose sight just before God is about to bring that birth in our life. And so how many of you here tonight recognize you're pregnant? Okay, I know Rachel and Shelby are. But if you're pregnant tonight, go ahead and stand up. And Paige, can we bind some of the things? Because see, the devil came to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus came that we would have life and life more abundant. That's what James was talking about, is seeing the full release of the abundant life of Jesus in and through the life that we live. Because if heaven and earth is a witness against you, what does a witness do? It testifies based on what it's seen and what it's heard. And so we want to give heaven and earth something to work with tonight as we speak the word. 2 Corinthians 4:13 says the spirit of faith is we believed and therefore we speak. Amen. And it's time that what we believe in our heart to be spoken with our mouth so it can be modeled with our life. Does that make sense? Can you lead us in binding and loosening tonight? Steve, would you mind just jumping up on the keys for us? Again, how many of you are pregnant tonight? All right. Listen, one of the things that God is doing tonight is he's extracting. You see, there's that we say it all the time, you know, there's a reason why they call, you know, Plan B the abortion pill. Because we've had, and I'm telling you, one of the worst things in your life can be the thought pattern that if God doesn't come through, I can do this. Because what's one of the highest forms of pride we could ever walk in? Because it's saying that God is not big enough to care for the things that matter to you. Amen? So can you lead us?
Father, we thank you so much that this is your word. Yes. We're appropriating your word and your truth to these people that you love so much, Lord. And they're pregnant, Father. They're pregnant with what you've put in their heart and their minds and their spirits. And so, Lord, I just pray to give them a download of what you want and as they live every day, every minute, even sleeping, Lord, you seal their instructions in dreams. So I just bind every hindering thing that's trying to keep this pregnancy from coming forth, to keep this thing from being birthed that they want. I bind that hindrance, a hindering thing, that tormenting, vexing, harassing spirit that would try to hinder them in any way from this birthing thing to come forth. Even in our church, if there's anything in this church building that's supposed to come forth with all these people in this church congregation, I bind any hindering thing that's trying to keep that from coming here. What you want here, Lord, heaven here. Heaven in their lives, Lord. They're waiting. Some of them have waited a long time, Lord. I thank you that waiting is over. We're just going to declare that waiting is over. Just like if somebody's pregnant and they're fixing to give birth, Lord, I say we're fixing to give birth and it's coming soon. In Jesus' name. And we bind doubt and unbelief from them. As I walk out of this place, the people on the web, that they will not go, oh, well, that was good. But that was for me. In Jesus' name. And Lord, that it would be full term. There'll be no aborted dreams, Lord, in Jesus' name. No aborted dreams in Jesus' name. Some of them have had dreams forever, and they have not seen them, but they are, let them be more pregnant than they even are now, that they're thinking about. As they go out, let that pregnancy get bigger and bigger, like when it shows then, Lord. You can be pregnant and it not show. So, Father, I thank you that pregnancy is going to show in them, and they're going to see what you're doing for them because you love them. So, Lord, we just bind anything that would hurt them or harm them, or their children, or their children's children, anything that's been on their minds that's harassing them, we bind that up. And loose it away from them in Jesus' name. We thank you for the tools you give us, the keys of the kingdom, and we're going to use them, and they're going to use them in Jesus' name. They're not going to go out here and go, that was a good message. They're going to go out here and use those tools that you have given us. I'm going to go out here and use those tools that you've given me. We are not going to forget. We're not going to grow weary in well-doing, in Jesus' name. Jesus' name.
And Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we bind the working of deception in our heart, in the heart of this house. And in the name of Jesus, we loose truth. We loose the Holy Spirit of truth to come and take of what the Father has given to the sons and make it manifest to sons and daughters here, sons and daughters represented in this house, throughout the whole family, Father. And Father, in the name of Jesus, you know, we can bind, in other words, we can bind and hold back the works of darkness while also loosing the kingdom and the works of light, but you can also bind in a positive way. For instance, I speak right now in the name of Jesus that we bind you to truth. I speak in the name of Jesus that we speak that we are bound to the Word of God, and we are loosed from the assignment of deception. We are loosed from the lies of the enemy, and we loose the liar from his assignment in the name of Jesus against this house and against each and every heart here and the heart of our city in the name of Jesus. And we just declare, devil, you are now unemployed as it relates to this house. And the thief is caught in the act and must pay back sevenfold. So we do. We lose sevenfold recompense, and we bind the thief in Jesus' name. Where there's been misunderstanding, misperception, and miscommunication, we bind all the fruit of those wrong and bad trees, and we lose clear communication in Jesus' name. We lose clarity of mind, and where there's been confusion, we lose joy in Jesus' name. We bind the work of confusion and deception and release honor, love, and humility in its place. In Jesus' name, God, we thank you, Lord, for what has been done tonight that we have seen with our eyes and heard with our ears. But God, we also thank you for those things that have been set in motion in your spirit, in our spirit, that will continue to produce life in the days ahead. Father, we say yay and amen to every promise of God in this place. We say yay and amen to your word from Genesis 1 to Revelations 22 and everything in between, that we would be a people fully baptized in your word and fully filled to overflow with your spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Steve, whatever's in your heart.
Freedom reigns in this place, and your showers of mercy and grace, they are falling on every face. There is Shower of mercy.
Father, we just declare in the name of Jesus, Lord, that our life would line up with your word in our heart and in our mouth. And Lord, that as we behold you, we become more like you. Steve's going to sing one more song, but I also want to just remind you guys, you know, Paige referenced her book. Jeff talked about that and Freeze Lily Bird. Those are available in the Connect Cafe. After the service, Amy will be out there. I think they're $10 a piece. And so be sure to take advantage of that. They make great Christmas gifts. And honestly, there's just, like I said, there's so much truth, there's so much scripture, and there's so much testimony and story in Paige. It's just amazing. Again, that the story of unforgiveness and Freeze the Lily Bird and the gift of forgiveness, not just letting others go free, but also allowing ourselves to go free. And Steve, I just kept hearing you sing that song that you wrote about this town. You know which one I'm talking about? Okay. My focus is always on this town. And Father, we thank you, Lord, that for what you're doing in this town. God, we thank you for Birmingham, Alabama. God, we thank you. God, we thank you for Birmingham, Alabama. And every promise of God to this place is yes and amen. God, we thank you that we didn't choose here, but here chose us. And Lord, you have brought us to this place for such a time as this to see your kingdom established and to see heaven come on earth. And so as we sing this song tonight, let it not just be a song we sing, but a declaration that we release and a truth we believe. And so do they have the words back there too? What's the name of it?
Send Your Rain.
Send Your Rain. Laura, if we could put that on the screen so everybody can sing along. And again, this is what Paige talked about. Decide to create a thing and the Lord will establish it. Send your rain.
Till the ground once again move clay with your hand. Come plow in your garden. Furrow soil overgrown. Sift rubble and stone. Days of hardened. Overflow to this valley below. From the
Father, we just agree with the sending of your rain, Lord, and the sound of your name being released to the life that we live as your glory remains. In Jesus' name. Just want to remind you this Friday night, we have our Friday night fire and movie night. It's our last one. I have a feeling it's just going to kind of be a worship explosion. And so you don't want to miss that. And also this Sunday, we've actually got a very special word we're going to be bringing to our house along the same lines of making room, but making room for the prophetic. And sometimes when you make room for the prophetic, you get things you didn't ask for. Sometimes it hurts worse for a season, but God can even bring those things you didn't ask for back to life in a way that actually makes your life more whole and more complete than it was before that blessing you didn't ask for came into your life. Amen? And so that's enough to get you curious, but not enough to lay out what we're going to be talking about. It's going to be awesome. So we love you guys. Be sure to see somebody tonight. Love on somebody before you go. We love you so much.